Anytime magma wells up into the crustal zone, so you have hot liquid rock in the crustal zone, that is known as volcanism. Volcanism comes in two types. Here's the first type: intrusive volcanism. Intrusive volcanism, like the name implies, means that the liquid rock, the magma, is still inside the planet. And of course, liquid rock inside the planet is known as magma. If that magma cools and it solidifies, it creates what are known as plutons. Plutons are intrusive volcanic features, or they're intrusive igneous features. Huh? You got that part right? Good. Here they are. So take a look at this diagram. These are the ones I want you to be responsible for: batholiths, stocks, pipes, sills, dikes, and laccoliths. Here's what each one of those are. A batholith, which I've circled there for you, is the largest of the intrusive volcanic features. More or less, this will have to be at least 40 square miles of solidified magma. Mostly, this is going to be granitic, in other words, granite. However, it can be significantly larger than 40 square miles. The Sierra Nevada in California is almost 500 miles long, and most of it is an uplifted batholith, which means that rock you're looking at one point, which is granite, was under the ground in a liquid form, cooled over a very long period of time, and then was uplifted along that normal fault that's on the eastern slopes of the Sierra Nevada. That exposed the Sierra Nevada batholith. A stock is the second largest intrusive igneous or intrusive volcanic feature. Unfortunately for the stock, and I know this is a little bit embarrassing for the stock, its main characteristic is that it's not as big as the batholith. It comes in second. It's a little bit like who came in second in the World Series, or who came in second in the NBA Finals last year, or who came in second in the Super Bowl. Yeah, I know that's the stock. So if it's less than 40 square miles, we call it a stock. A pipe is a conduit through which liquid rock, magma, flows to the surface and feeds a volcano, which you can see circled there. So if a volcano is going to form, what's going to have to happen is magma is going to have to reach the surface and then flow out or blow out onto the surface. It reaches the surface through a pipe. Sills are formed when magma squeezes between sedimentary strata, cools, and solidifies, which you can see circled there. If you take a good look at this photograph that I have, that darker colored rock, those are sills. The lighter colored rock, that's sedimentary rock. So what happened was magma came up into the crust, squeezed between the sedimentary strata, cooled, and solidified. Those are sills. Now, if you have a lot of magma that comes up into the crust, it's going to cause pressure on the layers of rock that are above it. That will cause the rock to crack. Because magma's liquid, that liquid will then squeeze into those cracks. When it cools and solidifies, it makes what's known as a dike. So dikes are formed when magma squeezes into cracks in the crust, cools, and solidifies. If it made it all the way to the surface and fed a volcano, that would be a pipe. But you can see by this diagram that it doesn't make it all the way to the surface. And if you look at this photograph, you can see the light colored limestone on either side, but the yellow arrow is pointing at that gray. That gray is intrusive igneous rock. And you can see the way it kind of cuts up and goes into what would have been a crack at one point in the rock. Finally, a laccolith. A laccolith is a bloated sill that forms a hill at the surface. So if you look at the sills down below, what I've circled is the laccolith. You can see that if you continue to fill those up with magma, what would happen is what you see happening there, which is that the laccolith would slowly lift up the layers of sedimentary strata, and that would cause a hill to form. When it cools and solidifies, that creates a laccolith.